November 7th, and I just completed hiking the Pacific Crest Trail. And my brother here, Tom, was awesome because he came and picked me and several other PCT hikers that had just completed the trail, picked us up off the trail, pulled us down the mountain, hosted us. And then the next day we went and got Machete off the mountain, pulled him down here.
Fed them all nectarines.
Oh my God, they were so good. And so we're gonna take off today for Seattle, but I wanted to share something really, really freaking amazing that Tom and his wife Gina are doing. It is truly one of those save the planet moments. The Methow Valley has been burning in terrible, horrible ways, had some of the worst air pollution on the planet this year. And they actually have some ways that they're looking to attack this problem and solve this problem. And they've got a bit of a Frankenstein machine over here. And I'm gonna have Tom give you a very brief rundown on the concept of what this is about, because this is a really strange looking machine and it's built that way specifically so they can take parts on and off and really do some experimentation with it. But Tom, can you just give us a quick little run through of what this concept's about?
Do you want the forest through here?
Yeah.
Okay, so for the last 100 or more years, we have been suppressing wildfires just wholesale. That's just been policy. And we're standing right above the world's first smoke jumper base, established in 1939. And the consequence of that now and past forest management practices is that we have taken away the forest's ability to weed itself, so to speak. So now, where there used to be historically 15 to 30 trees per acre, now there are several hundred, maybe up to 1,000, because all of the little low intensity fires that would burn every 7 to 15 years and keep the little trees down, we've put those out. And now those little trees are this big around and 100 years old. And those are the real problem for fueling these catastrophic, historically unprecedented mega fires that we're seeing all over the Western US. So, I mean, right back here, you can see where we've burned just this year, 125,000 acres here down in the low country and threatened multiple communities with evacuations. These fires have been chasing people around like rats. And the air quality, like you said, we were in just this year that we were in a feature article in the Washington Post saying we had the worst air quality in the nation, if not the world. So fast forward, my wife Gina and I have conceived a way to address this issue, with the real problem being that these little trees have no commercial value. And so the cost of removing those, which they have to come out to save the big trees and the health of the forest, it's so costly and there's no revenue that can be generated by it. There's really not enough money on the planet to do the job the way we're doing it now, where it's just typically they get cut, put in slash piles and burned.
And you're calling this forest health management.
Forest health management. So even if you could do that, all of the carbon stored in those trees is being released to the atmosphere, either by combusting it, or if they're just left on the ground to rot, when they do that, they're releasing that carbon in the form of carbon dioxide back in the atmosphere.
And what is the problem with releasing that carbon back into the
so
atmosphere?
So what this these super dense forests represent is historically unprecedented concentrations of atmospheric carbon that's been captured by the trees through photosynthesis and stored until it's released somehow, whether it's, you know, through fires or just decomposition. So that carbon is obviously the big thing that's driving climate change on a global scale. So what we actually have here is, despite its look, is a surprisingly high-tech machine. that's called a pyrolysis reactor. And I know people freak out at the term reactor, but it technically it is, and it's not a bomb. It can't blow up. So what pyrolysis does is take biomass feedstock, like this non-merchantable material from the forest, and you put it into this machine that heats it well beyond typical combustion temperatures, but in the absence of oxygen, so it can't burn in the typical sense. But what it does do is drive off all the volatile compounds and leaves the carbon structures. And so you're essentially retaining fully half of the carbon of that biomass in a material called biochar that is chemically stable, in that it really doesn't readily decompose. And this is actually nothing new. This is the basis for the terra preta in the Amazon from 4,000 years ago. This is what made those soils productive, is biochar. So we are proposing to take this excess forest health, these materials, and use biochar and the other byproducts to make value-added materials that we can absorb the cost of paying for those forest health treatments that are not happening otherwise. And sequester the carbon for hundreds or thousands of years. So typically, this is used as a soil, an agricultural soil amendment, where it can do a whole bunch of things, like dramatically increase the water holding capacity, the nutrient holding capacity. You can modify the pH of the soil, makes really tremendous soil microbial habitat, which is really a big deal. And it's locked in the soil for essentially eternity. So that's one of the many uses. There's a whole bunch of other ones that are really intriguing, but I don't think we have time to go through that.
But that's the point of this machine. What you're doing is the research to find viable markets for this.
Yes.
How we can take this, instead of putting it back in the atmosphere, put it into products that we can all use that are much healthier for the world.
Exactly. Exactly. So this is a research machine that's part of our research and demonstration project. So the main species we have up in the forest that need to come out are ponderosa pine and Douglas fir. So we are researching the optimal processing characteristics to make ponderosa pine and Douglas fir into the most valuable products that they can become.
Right.
And hopefully, and I think this is really coming, because we're not the only ones to have thought of this. This is happening all over the world and globally. This pyrolysis is what the process is called, pyrolysis, is blowing up worldwide.
Yeah.
I mean, this has become, people are recognizing on a global scale the significance that pyrolyzing excess biomass can be. So what we're essentially doing is using nature's carbon capture mechanism, which is photosynthesis, and then processing that more or less into coal and putting it back in the ground.
Right.
So we're coal mining in reverse.
Right, I love that. So like even China's getting on board with this. I mean, in a big way.
China is maybe like leading the world. China and the Scandinavian countries, China is moving into this in a massive way, because not only can you do biomass, you can do other products like tires, plastics, you know, medical waste. You can do all kinds of things and essentially extract the oil out of it and reuse that and retain the carbon that you can use for all kinds of agricultural and industrial uses.
Right, so you're just trying to take that concept and see how it fits into this valley, into these areas.
Yes.
And then create a template that can be replicated in similar
exactly
areas.
So this valley is not unique. There's dozens, hundreds of them around the Western US, you know, British Columbia, Siberia, on and on and on. So we're trying to develop the template of how you do this on a local scale, because the real cost problem is hauling the lowest value materials like the forest waste.
Yep.
Hauling that. So the farther you have to haul that, the less economically viable it is.
Right.
So we're building this around a 35-mile haul radius.
Nice.
A 70-mile circle as what we can reach to, and figuring out what's the most cost-effective way we can get that material to a plant and make these higher value products that can then be transported a little bit farther.
Right.
And then when we have that template, it can be, you know, just over the hill in Okanagan,
right,
or Tenasket, or down in the Wenatchee Valley. It can be just freely replicated. So we're a nonprofit. We're not in this for money, because we're not making any money. But this template will be available to anybody.
Right. It's truly a save the world type of project.
Yeah.
One last thing. This pile right here, is this a good example of what you're talking about?
Yeah, this is a perfect example. So this is county right-of-way clearing maintenance. So they're clearing this material from the right-of-ways so that it doesn't do things like start fires from the power lines.
Right.
And that sort of thing. So typically this material, they pile it up here. This is really a big pile. And then they burn it. And so we are going to take...
Just release some more carbon into the atmosphere.
Yeah, and smoke. So, you know, the air quality thing is... A lot of people don't really understand how bad it can get. So when your air quality index stays, you know, between 300 and 400 and gets up... I saw it as high as 900. Oof. Here, which means... You could see about as far as those bushes back there,
right,
and that's it. You couldn't see across the valley. It gets that bad, and it's to the point that you just almost can't live with it. You don't go outside.
Right.
So this process, when done properly, generates exactly zero smoke. So our emissions from this will be mostly carbon dioxide and water. And we're working on some tricks to actually maybe capture 100% of the carbon.
Unreal.
So the only emission, and this is down the road, this chemistry is being experimented with right now at Washington State University. It's conceivable that we could capture 100% of the carbon and the only emissions would be water. And actually, we could capture that water and generate water. In fact, from the big plants we're looking at, we could potentially generate about 200 gallons of water per hour from those plants.
Right.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Okay, cool. So one last thing. If somebody who sees this gets excited about this and they want to support you guys in some way, how can they do that? How would they contact you, and what are you guys looking for as a way of support?
So
you got, by the way, you did get state funding from the state legislature?
Yes. So this is a big enough deal that our state senator and our district senator and both representatives and the chair of the Senate Ways and Means Committee all got together, and this biennium gave us a direct legislative appropriation for the biennium, the next 2 years, to operate this R&D project.
Right.
So they believe in it enough that's like... Yep.
Let's get this started.
Yeah, I mean, the budget was tight, but they still were able to squeeze us in,
right,
for a lot of money for us. It's the thing that's going to make this possible.
Right.
So if anybody wants to find out more or figure out how they can help, c6forest2farm.org is our website.
C6.
Yeah, the letter C, the number 6, the letter F, C6F2F.org is our website.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right, guys. Man, I had to share this because I just think it's a phenomenal thing what they're doing. And it's, as especially PCT hikers this year, one of the big things that we faced, our biggest threat was, how do you get through this trail without a forest fire? I was extremely fortunate to stay just ahead of the fires, But like all of the southbound, the Sobos, they got really hosed this year. They head into California. That whole PCT area just got shut down. The force, everybody knows at this point how bad these fires have gotten. And these guys are in the center of this, and they're really trying to do something incredible about this. And so if you can help out in any way, and there's some any kind of support you can do, that would be awesome. Thank you, guys. Thanks, Tom.
Thank you.
Hey, guys. Since the time I did that interview with Tom, an online organization called Investigate West did a fantastic and thorough, in-depth report on what they're doing. I'm including a link to that article in the description below. I think if you're really interested in what they're doing, this is a very descriptive and thorough article that's being picked up by major publications around the world. So be sure to check that out.